Well, greetings. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Owen Taylor, and I have the pleasure of being the pastor here at Beaver Dam and Rousey's Chapel. And I'm thankful that you have joined us for our time of worship here on this February 25th morning. It is definitely a beautiful day that God has made for us. So let's go ahead and begin our time of worship. I always like to start our time off by thanking those folks who help make worship possible. There's a team of people working in the background who help support and make our worship time together possible. And if you happen to be joining us live or throughout the day, give us a little shout out there on Facebook to let us know that you're watching. And if this time together has spoken to you in any way, I encourage you to drop us a line there in the comment box. Let us know what is on your mind, and also to hit that like and share key so that others can also hear the message. But for now, let's open with a word of prayer, shall we? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. God, we come to you this day on the second step of our Lenten journey. We come with a great hope and expectation as we walk in the way of Christ. Today's journey will demand much from us. And Jesus, we know that you make us ready to offer ourselves to you. God, come and let us begin again this wondrous excursion. And may your peace be placed in our lives, so that we can see your abiding love that is always present with us. We ask for all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our first reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, and this is Matthew chapter 6, verses 16 through 18. And this is Jesus speaking. So listen to these inspired words. And when you fast, don't put on a sad face like the hypocrites. They distort their faces so that people will know that they're fasting. I assure you that they have their reward. When you fast, brush your hair, wash your face. Then you won't look like you're fasting to people, but only to your Father who is present in that secret place. Your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And then we're continuing our journey through the Gospel of Mark. And today we find ourselves in chapter 9, verses 42 through 50. And last week we left off with Jesus teaching his disciples about letting the children come to him. So this is Jesus continuing to speak. As for whoever curses these little ones who believe in me to trip and fall into sin, it would be better for them to have a huge stone hung around their necks and to be thrown into the lake. If your hand causes you to fall into sin, chop it off. It's better for you to enter into a life crippled than to go away with two hands into the fire of hell, which can't be put out. If your foot causes you to fall into sin, chop it off. It's better for you to enter life lame than to be thrown into hell with two feet. If your eye causes you to fall into sin, tear it out. It's better for you to enter God's kingdom with one eye than to be thrown into hell with two. That's a place where worms don't die and the fire never goes out. Everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good. If salt loses its saltiness, how will it become salty again? Maintain salt among yourselves and keep peace with each other. Friends, for the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God. Amen. So when was the last time you fasted? Was it for a doctor's appointment? Or were you trying one of those juice cleanses, which is a type of fasting? Or perhaps you gave intermittent fasting a try. You followed one of those fad diets of like the 16-8 diet, where you eat for 8 hours and you fast for 16. Fasting is a holy habit, is something that I don't think too many people put into practice these days. But it is a practice that we see throughout the Bible. If we go back to Genesis, we see that Moses was one of the first ones that we read about fasting. Moses fasted for 40 days on Mount Sinai after God gave him the Ten Commandments. King David fasted and prayed for his son's recovery. The prophet Elijah fasted for 40 days at Mount Horeb before his encounter with God. And then how can we forget the story of Jonah, that once he got out of the whale and went to Nineveh to proclaim God's judgment on those people, their king responded by declaring a fast and repenting of their sins. And then we see the story of Queen Esther, Mordecai, and the Jewish people, and how they fasted for 3 days before Esther approached King Xerxes to plead for their safety. The Jewish people fasted on the Day of Atonement as part of their tradition. They fasted as a form of purification. And the Pharisees, well, they fasted typically on Mondays and Thursdays. So you can see that by the time we get to Jesus's day, fasting wasn't anything new. And I'm sure you remember how Jesus fasted for 40 days when he was in the wilderness after being baptized. So it should come to no surprise to you that our text from Matthew this morning starts with Jesus saying, when you fast. Not if you fast, but when you fast. It was part of their culture. Have you ever tried fasting as a spiritual discipline? I wondered this week why fasting isn't typically part of our spiritual life. Why don't we fast on a regular basis? I feel we've gotten away from fasting for several reasons. First, we really don't need to fast because of a lack of food. For the most part, we have plenty of food. We're not going to starve. But secondly, I think we've gotten away from fasting because our lives are super busy. We work long work hours. There never seems to be enough hours in the day to get everything done. The idea of fasting just seems impractical with the demands that we see in our lives. And we tell ourselves, we need to eat. We need to eat because we need the fuel that food provides. Another thought, whether we like it or not, we have grown accustomed to a lifestyle of convenience and a lifestyle of instant gratification. We as a society thrive on having what we want when we want it. Think about Amazon. Fasting challenges that. Fasting is self-control. It's moderation, and it's denial for the immediate. Now, there are some legitimate and practical reasons why we don't fast as well. Some of us have medication that we take that needs to be taken with food. There are blood sugar issues that some suffer from, and other medical things that keep us from fasting. And that's why complete fasting is not an option. And I want you to hear this. If fasting is going to be a danger to your health, please, please don't fast. There are other things that you can do in the place of abstaining from food. Because remember, the reason that we fast is to grow closer to God. When we fast, God is working through our denial. John Wesley viewed fasting as one of the means of grace, alongside prayer, Bible reading, and participation in the sacraments. Wesley believed that fasting, when practiced with the right intention and spirit, could deepen one's relationship with God and lead to spiritual growth. In fact, while he did not designate specific days for fasting, Wesley encouraged Methodists to fast on Wednesdays and Fridays as an example of what the early Christians did traditionally, to fast on those days to commemorate Jesus's betrayal and crucifixion. Wesley saw fasting as a way to exercise self-denial and discipline over one's desires and appetites. When we do without, when we detach ourselves from, we are detaching ourselves from material desires and pleasures, and it allows us to focus more on our spiritual well-being. John Wesley believed that by voluntarily abstaining from food or other pleasures, we could strengthen our spiritual resolve and overcome temptation. One way to look at fasting is that instead of eating food, we are feasting on the presence of God. Now, feasting on God involves more than just abstaining from food. It's about the heart and the intention behind the act. When we approach fasting with a clear intention to draw closer to God, we can use that time that we typically spend on eating to engage in prayer, meditation, and self-reflection. We should be directing our thoughts and desires towards God and seeking God's presence. And we do this from a place of surrender. We surrender our physical desires and appetites to God. And when we willingly deny ourselves of food, we are demonstrating our dependence on God and our desire for spiritual nourishment. This surrender also comes with a level of humility. Fasting guides us to cultivate a sense of humility as we recognize our own limitations and weaknesses. We acknowledge our need for God's strength and guidance in our lives. Ultimately, the goal of fasting is to deepen our relationship with God, to align our heart with God's purposes for our lives, and to experience God's presence in a deeper and more meaningful way. So this might raise the question in your mind, what type of fast are there? And what type of fast is right for me? I want to reiterate that before you start any type of fast, please consider your health and make sure you take care of yourself first and foremost. The most typical way that we traditionally think of fasting is a full day fast, where we abstain from all food for a day. We drink waters and juices, but we don't eat any form of solid food. Now, if this isn't an option for you because of medical reasons, or you may feel that you need to work up to a full day fast, you can try what is known as an intermittent fast. An intermittent fast is where you might abstain from one or two meals during the day. And there's also a partial fast, which is where you can avoid certain types of food for a longer period of time. Think of it like giving up sweets like ice cream or chocolate for the season of Lent. Now, fasting doesn't necessarily have to be limited to abstaining from food. It can also involve abstaining from activities or indulgences as a form of this holy habit of spiritual practice. You can fast from things like social media. Wouldn't do it on Sunday because you're joining us here in worship, but the normal scrolling that you do. You can fast from TikTok. This type of fast can provide you with a break from the constant connectivity and distraction from that social media brings. It allows you a time for self-reflection that comes with fasting. You can also fast from other technology, like TVs and computers and even our phones. You can fast from personal comforts. Think about not running the heat and air conditioning in your car. Or maybe think about using the clothes dryer and going back to hanging clothes outside. Ultimately, the goal of fasting from non-food items is to cultivate a self-discipline of mindfulness and spiritual growth by temporarily abstaining from activities and indulgences. Those activities and indulgences that distract us and hinder our relationship with God. Now, for this season of Lent, as we take a look at these holy habits, I told you guys last week that we would have challenges each week. So for the challenge of this week, I would like for you to consider how you can fast this coming week. Perhaps fast for the rest of Lent. Next Sunday, I encourage you to fast before you come to worship. Maybe you skip breakfast or skip dinner and breakfast. Or maybe you just skip your morning's coffee until you can hear the Word of God and feed on that spiritual nourishment. It's a place where we can hear God's grace. Now, if you want to go deeper in fasting, I would like to suggest that you consider a couple of different levels to our fasting challenge. The first is to fast for 1 or 2 days during the week. Remember to drink plenty of fluids. And if that isn't speaking to you, then perhaps try 1 or 2 of those non-food items to fast from. Fast from social media, or fast how much you watch television. The key is that whenever you are longing for what you're fasting from, be it food or the computer or whatever, that you turn your focus towards God. You know, if we turn back to the text from this morning, there's one last piece of advice that Jesus gives us when we fast. Jesus says that when you fast, don't put on a sad face like the hypocrites. Folks around you shouldn't know that you're fasting. Fasting is definitely between you and God. But I don't think that means that we don't tell anyone. I actually think it's a good idea that if you choose to fast, that you fast with a small group of people who you can trust. I say this because we really aren't meant to practice our faith alone. Sure, God sees what we do in secret, but we need each other for love and support. It's our inner circle of fellow believers that help hold us accountable when we try to live into some of these spiritual disciplines or holy habits. I mean, think about it. The disciples had each other to lean on. So when Jesus told them to brush your hair and wash your face when you're fasting, I really don't think Jesus was saying, don't tell anyone what you're doing. But what he was telling them is to be selective in who knows. That it's all about the why you are fasting. It's about how fasting helps you grow closer to God. It's about your intention of fasting from the things of the world so that you can feast on God. Feasting on the grace that comes from fasting. That, my friends, is the reward that comes from God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, friends, I hope you've enjoyed our time together. So receive this benediction as we go forth to take on this day and this week. Friends, go with the challenge of finding ways to grow in your faith. Go with the challenge of fasting this week. Fasting so that you can feast on the presence of God. Go with the blessings of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace, y'all. Bye for now.